are on page 60b, nine lines from the bottom of the page. Several subjects we're going to cover in this daf. First is the idea of the obligation of nursing a child, continuation of the previous session. The idea is they have a baby, regardless if it's a boy or girl, and unfortunately there is a serious conflict, divorce involved, and she's nursing the child. She made up her mind that she's not interested anymore to nurse the child. Do we, the husband, or in our discussion can be the ex, can force her, especially if it's a life-threatening situation for the child, the baby refused to nurse from anyone else. And the serious question is, how far we go with that. If she does that, she get paid, and how far she will get paid, who's supposed to pay her, if she can hire someone else to do it, etc. Another subject we're going to talk is the moral obligation at the walking place, which again indirectly also connected to that. In those days they used to nurse for payment. Go back to biblical time, we read about Moses, that he refused to nurse from another mother. So how far we go with that moral obligation, not only in that case but also in general. Also, time is allowed, we're going to discuss the conflict between honoring parents and shalom bayit. For example, if a person have a elderly father who's out of the hospital and the father wish to, and the son too, wish to live together with his son for the rest of his life, the wife refuses it, and the question is, does she have any obligation to her father-in-law? If it's a conflict between shalom bayit, peace in the house, versus honoring father, how far a person needs to go with honoring his father. So again, we are page 60b, nine lines from the bottom of the page. Tanu rabanan, harei shenatnu la ben lehanik. They hire a professional nurse to nurse a child, a baby. Harei zo lo tenik imo lo bna velo ben chaverta. So since she was hired, the nurse was hired for payment, she may not nurse her own child or another woman's child together with him, in order that she not take away milk from this child that she'd been paid to nurse. Paska kim'a, if she fixed a small allowance for food, with payment for nursing, meaning in a way you can compare it to a regular working environment that a person have a break, etc., etc. So they said, ochelet harbe. So because it was a stop, she must nevertheless eat large quantities so she will have enough milk. Now, another halakha, lo tochal imo dvarim haraim lechalav. So, since she needs to nurse the child, she may not eat together with him, which means while she is nursing the child, things that are very bad for for her milk. This is, by the way, soon you see a lot of issue in halakha. If a person, for fun or for all kind of reasons, eating unhealthy food, so it's a big question if you're allowed to harm yourself, but let's say you like the taste, so you want to eat all this junk stuff. But what happens if it's a mother that nursing a child, especially if you're nursing a child for payment, if you're allowed to eat something that creates a unhealthy milk? So the Gemara said, Hashta bna amart lo, now you tell me that she may not nurse her own child together with a client's child, because she was hired to nurse some baby, ben chaverta mi baya. So you have the issue of another woman's child. So the Gemara said, "Mao de teima benahu de chais ilavei umam tzelei tfei." Aval ben chaverta ilav ha mutar la lav imatzia lekamashman. So sometimes that's the human nature. She's taking care of her own child. So if it's his own child, so she looking for it, she give her more, she give her from her own, from her capability, but in a way she will not leave enough for the one that she was hired for. So here the brighter teaches that she cannot nurse even the child of her friend because of that paska kim'a. But even she fixed a small allowance for food. Ochelet arbe, she must eat large quantity. Meheicha, so the big question is from where she will get the food that the allowance cannot cover it. So who's paying it? The one who hired her or from her own? Amar Rav Sheshet Mishela, Rav Sheshet said from her own fund. Why is that? Because she accepted the obligation to nurse the child. So therefore, she must take the necessary steps to fulfill all of her obligations. So the Biuri said that we have the assumption that she is happy with her salary and she willing to take this allowance expenses out of her own pocket. The Rambam, as we said, the Maimonides have a big discussion if it's an unhealthy food and she liked that food and if she allowed to do it, again, if she was hired as a nurse to nurse a child of someone else, and that's something that may even harm the baby if she is allowed by halacha to eat that. Anyway, the Gemara here elaborates on that. This is a story about the late Rav Vozhner, which we mentioned many times, of Bnei Brak, may rest in peace. They, for example, if the mother is in a threatening situation over a sight, and they said that she had to miscarriage the child, otherwise she's going to lose her sight capability. Is that permissible or not? Rav Vozhner have a response on that. Or for example, if somebody in a family needs an organ, and does a woman allow to do miscarriage of something that they don't see a much future, in order to take some organ of this fetus and hooked it to someone who's in need? It's a big response, or a Vozhner deal with that. Anyway, you see the consequence of this discussion that go even further in halacha. So the brayta said, "Lo tochal limot dvarim ara'im," that she should not eat something that it's not good for her quality of the milk. Ma'inin hu. So what exactly it applies? So they said, "Amar Rav Kahana kigon kshut." Rav Kahana said, for example, hops, which means that this is like a beer. The idea is that it's a green herb. It doesn't have much ground, and the Gemara said in Bava Metzia 42 that they use it to make a wine or alcoholic beverages. More correct to say not wine, but beer. Vechaziz and a yam. Vedagim ktanim, and a small fish. Va'adama, and also the green grain, sprout, and small, and soil. Amar Abaye amar afilu kara v'chavusha. Abaye said even pumpkin and quince. So all this problematic. Rav Papa amar afilu kora v'chufra. So Rav Papa said even it's a kuta. It's like a kamka and small fried fish. And so all of these items are bad. Rabbi Shemar Afiru kamka v'harsana said this kamka, it's again, harsana is a small fish. So they combine it with the fat and dough, it's bad. Minayu paske chalva, minayu achri chalva. So they said one of them, all of these items are bad. Some cause milk to dry up and some cause milk to spoil. So the Hafla'ah have a discussion over the manna, the story of manna from heaven. So they say that they have, for example, watermelon and kishuim and things like that. It's not healthy for a mother nursing a child. So how you do that? So they said the miracle of the manna, it doesn't affect, but in general, it is an issue to eat something that is unhealthy. Nemshamsha berechaya, which means that if the mother, certain behavior affected the child, which modern researchers prove it, but anyway, women engage in intercourse in the will, so they said that that have an effect that the child will be epileptic. הבו לבני נכפה, ומשם שעל ארעה, הבו לבני שמוטה, דחל רמד החמרה, הבו לבני גרידי. Again, we need to understand the concept. The idea is that if it's intercourse or a certain way, they have a certain effect. One speak about step on a donkey dung that the pregnant or have a bald children, etc. We need to understand the concept, especially the conceptualist time and full understanding. We just read first. דח לאחר ולאו לבני זלזנה, דח לתחלי, אבו לבני דולפנה, דח למונני, אבו לבני מציצי, עיינה, דח לגרגושתה, אבו לבני מכוערי, לשד השיחרה, אבו לבני הוקמה, דח לביסרה ושד החמרה. So all this example of effectiveness of a mother pregnant, the way the manner of she eats, she hear, she use her five senses and how it's affected for good or bad in the future children. Again, modern researchers prove it. Havu lebnei, she will have a children who are healthy. 61, braye, da'ach labi, havu lebnei anane, da'ach lakavare, for eating fish, you mean large fish, havu lebechine nane, it's a good, beautiful children. Da'ach lakarpes, havu lebnei zivtane, which means beautiful in such different way. Da'ach lakusbarta, havu lebisne bisrane, they say that if she eat kusbarta, it's like corridor, so have a couple of children. דאחלה אתרוג אבו לבני רחנה, שמרדה אית אתרוגים, they'll have used them, they have smells good, children. They said ברטי דשבור מלכה אחלה באימא אתרוגה, אבו מסקלה כמדה אבוה בריש רחנה. This is a story about King Shafor of Persia, that the mother ate the trogin, which she was pregnant, and they said that they put it in front of her father, top of this of the spices, as she was so pregnant. Again, we need to understand, but here the Gemara is going to deal with the chiyuv, the obligation of a woman to nurse her child. Amar Ravuna, bedak la Ravuna bar Chinana. He omeret leanik, v'hu omer shelo leanik. She wants to nurse the baby. He said no. Her beauty, her appearance will be damaged if she nurses the child. So what do you do? So shonim atzar mitavli. You have to listen to her because that's her body, that's her sorrow. So because if she increases in her carrying milk and it's not in use, it creates a sorrow. You know, because it's like she filled with the milk and she need to. I know that in the modern days sometimes they even take out the milk just to release her if she's not nursing the child. הוא אומר להניק והיא אומרת שלא להניק מהו. If he insisted that he wants her to nurse the child and she said no, I don't want to do that. So he said כל היכה דלאו אורחה. So you have to go by the manner of the family. So if the family, they are so rich, they're giving somebody else to nurse the children, in those days שומעים לה. היא אורחה והוא לאו אורחי מהי, בתר דידי הזה ובתר דידי הזגן, ובשם מה עולה אמו ונורדת אמו. So it means that she is raised to his level, not step to his level. So basically, in that sense, you go by his minhagim. Maravukuna ravuna maikra. You bring a pasuk that said about Avimelech in Bereshit in Genesis 20, page, chapter 20. Vehi bulat bat, and she is married woman. So it means baligato shel bal veligato shel bal. She is ascendant and descendant of the husband. Rabbi Lazar amar me'acha ki hayta em kol chay. Let's talk about Chava, about Eve, that she was mother of all humans. So Pnei Yoshua explained that Abimelech asked Hashem, he says, what did I do wrong? He said that Sarah is my sister, Abraham told him. So what do you want? So they said, lo bulat bal, he cannot make it allowance because, again, she ascend to him, not descend to him. Lechaim natna velo letzar natna. So the idea is that she was giving, Chava, she was giving to her husband for living with him, but not giving to suffer pain with him. So the Maharsha asked a question. She is the cause of death in the world. But again, the idea I explained that she is attached to Adam, to the first man, that's giving life. Ichnisa lo shifcha, if she brought a mate, so she doesn't need to grind and cook or laundry. Hashe era avda, ותאים עלי אילית להחיד את הבחריקאי. So I brought you another woman to do this job. What do you want from me? So I explained in my book, Rashi said here, במקומי ולנראה לשון חיד כקרן, כלומר לשון קידה המקום, בפגן מקומי ובגמי. So based on the page 105, the Gemara said, אמר לו, הבו לי גברה דדה לי בחריקאי. So the idea is that these two different גרסאות, חריקאי, is like the Gemara in Chulin 59, that is like the carnaim, the head that they make harukot. Rashi meant to say that it's like mashal nimshal, that is like an allegory. So it's speak about adama pogem, a person that created another result. The person created that harikai. Mishum da'amar le'tarcha, ha'tarcha le'di ve'ledida. She will make an effort for me and for herself. Kamedidach ma'itarach. But for you, who will toil for you? It is necessary for a wife to do some work in order to cover some of her own expenses. So then the Mishnah said, "Shtayminam v'shel v'namanika." If she brought him two maid servants, she does not need to cook. She does not need to nurse her child. Hashara avda v'temala ha'ilit li'itach achriti detach al di'vda v'chaz al di'vda. I brought to her that she should do the job. Mishum damar la. The husband said to her, "Kame orche u'parchi mantarach." So he said, who is going to toil for the guests and for the wayfarers who come because we have a large household. So there is still other tasks that need to be performed. So Rashba explained that from here we derive that she needs to take care of all the other member of the household that around the husband. The Ritva said it's only for temporary guests. But the Mishnah Lemelech in Ilchot Ishut, chapter 21, expanded at length. Then the Mishnah said, Shalosh Elam Matzat Amitah. If she brought three maid servants, she doesn't need to prepare the bed for him. Hashara Avda. V'teim Aliyata Ali Achrir Lohche V'Parchi. I brought you another one, so what do you want from me? And Mushanah Nafshit Bimet Nafshit Lohche V'Parchi. When there are many people, there are many guests and wayfarers. Yache Afilu Arba Nami. So even four. So Arba Kvan Nefishinu Masayin La'adadi. Because there are so many guests, so many maid, so there are many of them, they assist one another and can complete all the necessary work. Amar Rav Chana v'itema Rabbi Shmuel bar Nachmani lo yechnisa lo mamash, lakivan shiruya lehechnis. Not necessarily that she actually brought all the maid servants, but she is able to bring maid servants. Once her dowry is sufficient, large to buy maid servant, then she is exempt from performing those tasks. As a side note, the rabbi said that one who married for money, the children never come out as the total proper future, because the whole marriage was basically in other motivation. So the rabbis opposed this type of attitude. Anyway, Tana, echad shehechnisa v'echad shetzimtzema lo mishela. So they said whether she brought him an actual maidservant or she reduced her own needs in order to release enough money to bring maidservant to work, she is exempt from that tasks. So Moshe Feinstein, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, have a big discussion over tzava, over will. It was a lady that all her life she saved money, which means the husband used to give her money, for example, for a maid to come and help, a cleaning lady, for all kind of expenses, and she saved and saved and saved all this penny, and eventually she had a large sum of money, and she left a will that the money go to her institution or someplace. And the big question is this is total her money or not? It's a big discussion, because again, the big question is if you go from the minimum or you go from the maximum. If it's total minimum and she followed his minimum requirement, then it's her and she can do whatever she wishes to. If it's from the other way, then it's not total her and therefore it's an issue. So then the Mishnah continued and said, Arba Yoshevet Bakatedra. So if she brought him four maid servant, she may sit in her chair and not do anything. So again, Amar Rav Yitzchak Bar Hanan Amar Rav Huna, Af Al Pi Shamru Yoshevet Bakatedra, Aval Mozegit Lo Kos, Matzalet Lo Amita, Machis Lo Panav El Arglav. So again, even in a way she can have all these conveniences, the rabbis here go at length to say that there are certain things she should do. For example, in those times, in Talmudic time, they cannot drink wine as easy. They need to combine it, diluted it with the water. Preparing the sheets, the linen. So Rashi explains, so Tosfot, the Mishnah, the Melech said in Hilchot Yishuv, chapter 21, that it's not an obligation, it's just something that the Bedin, the Rabbinic Court, cannot enforce it, but since it's some type of manner that which a husband and wife get close, it's a good advice, good counsel the sages give to our daughters to do it in order to establish a good relationship between husband and wife. ואמר רב יצחק בר חנניה, אמר רב מונה, כל מלאכות שהאישה עושה לבעלה, נידה עושה לבעלה, חוץ מזיגת הכוס, בצעת המיטה, והחצת פנה בדבר אליו. So it's called ימי חיבה. So it means that when she have their period, the big question is, she can do certain things. So in הלכה, they say that it's all depend upon if he's in the present there or not. Because anything that establish a connection which may lead to a physical connection, that's a issue. והצעת המיטה אמר רבה לא אמרה נעלה בפניו ושלא בפניו לתלם בה. As we said, that when it's come to preparing the bed and things like that, so the way that the Levush in Yoredea in Kuf Tzadik Hei explained to us that if it's involved in any manner to be connected, then it's a issue. The Minchat Yitzchak, the late Dayan Weiss, as well as the Shevet Alevi, have a discussion over Netilat Yadayim in the morning. There is a washing hand in the morning, if she's in a state of nida, if she's permitted to do it or not. Anyway, ומזיגת הכוס, שמואל מחלפה לדיביתו בידה דיסמאלה. The wife of Shmuel, which was a luminary sage, she was to exchange and make it in the left hand. So Tosfot explained that that's the concept of nida, that is the oraita, it's a biblical. So in those days they used to do a two-time tevila. They do one-time tevila right after the nida, and then at the end of the nikim period, then seven nikim, then they do another tevila. Abaye manach le'apuma dechuva. In Abaye, she used to put the cup on the top of that barrel of wine. Rava abay sadia. She used to put the pillow on top of his head. Rav Papa ashar shifa. So again, it's the small, like a small bench. One of the questions was asked for the former Satmar Rebbe was about a situation that someone come to his in-laws and he's very uncomfortable. People should know the status of his wife, if it's okay for him to pour to her cup, for example, a cup of wine, etc. So if it's okay, because basically in one way it's appear okay from her to him, but from him to her, that the Rashba said, he quote the Rashba, that it go both ways. So it's a response, if it's okay or not, especially he doesn't want other people to know the status. אמר רב יצחק בר חנניה אמר רב הונא, הכל משהים בפני השמש, חוץ מבשר ויין. And here we have another discussion, which is there's someone who's a waiter in the restaurant. So he come and he save you, and while he's saving you, Isaac will tell you, right, that sometimes you save people with tremendous expensive meat and wine, and you just look at that food and you want to eat some of this food, right, Steve? Yes, you smell it, you carry, you go to the kitchen, you take it from the chef or whatever it is, you go to serve people and you smell it, and, right, so he said, אמר חיסדה, בשר שמן ויין ישן. Here we apply a very expensive meat and old wine. המרב הבשר שמן כל השנה כולה, אני שם על תרופת חמוז. We talk about heavy meat is all year round. When it's come to aged wine, is only during the season of Tammuz, which is the summertime. Due to the heat, the aroma of the wine is more than the at that time. אמר רב ענן בר תחליפה, הווה קמינא קמיה דמר שמואל והייתו לי תבשילה דארדי ואילה דאהיב לי איסטקיני. So I serve like a mushroom, and if he didn't give me something, I'll be in a dangerous situation. It's a story about the Rav Meislish, who is a great Rav in Europe. So he went to collect money for the poor people. It was in the middle of the cold winter. So he knocked the door of the rich guy. He opened the door, and the role of the community, he was standing there at the door. The guy was half-dressed, Rav Meisblum was fully dressed, and he was talking with him to collect the money for the poor people, and the guy was listening, and was ready to prepare some money for him and everything. So he said, Rabbi, come in. You're already talking to me for a few minutes. It's a freezing cold, and we're standing at the entrance of my house, and just come in, and we, you know, I'll, you know, prepare the money, write for you the check, and do all of that. Why we need to stand at the front of the door, and it's very cold, and you see I'm not fully dressed. And Rav Meisblum said to him, that's the whole purpose. I wanted to understand how the mindset of those poor people in this freezing cold, so I purposely standing here, and I do that on purpose, I torturing you, because I wanted to write a big check for them and to have the feeling of those people who are in great need. Amar Rav Ashi, Hava Kamina Kamede Rav Kahana, Vaitu Gar Gelidei Delifta Bechala. I combine these pieces with vinegar, Vila Avdi Ahibli Istekene. So again, same story, that if you don't share with me something, I'll be in that hunger, into the domain of dangers. Now, Papa Amar Afilu Tmarta Dehaninuta. So here he used an example. Rav Kahana said that even it's a date, that heavy date that you don't give me, that I'll be in a dangerous. So the Magen Avraham, he brings the Shla Kadosh. He said that it's a big question about the someone who's like a waitress. If there is a knife, is a condition, if this is an effective condition or not, because it's involved with the sorrow of the body. So it's he basically challenged that condition, because again, a person cannot commit himself for something that's above his physical capability. Klala de Militas and Gmar put together the final conclusion.
They're gonna tell me now, right?
Yeah, in a few minutes.
Oh, you will
tell me? Yeah, in a few minutes.
Oh, very good.
Just waiting for the last person.
Oh, very good.
Okay. Klala de Milta called the itle recha ve itle kiyuha. Whenever they have a very strong aroma, very strong smell, or a taste of a vinegar, so that if a reach a person to a danger, so you don't eat it before at the front of his face. So there's a story about the Kovna Rav that people used to come to him for Shabbat meal. And when they come to him for Shabbat meal, what happened is, he was very makpid, very strict, not to have a conversation or anything, make a kiddush, wash hands, and start the meal. Chafetz Chaim in particular was very strict with that, because that's what happens sometimes with people. You have a guest. I read a letter one time from someone who came to Baltimore, and he felt very strongly about it. You have a guest. They come to your house, you live in a big, beautiful home, for example, with all these conveniences and food, the guest is hungry, right? Especially Shaliach from Eretz Yisrael or something like that, right? So they got to your house, Shabbos, you walk slowly from the shul, you talk Torah, you bless the children, there you go on, and the guest is dying to eat something. He may be hungry, didn't eat all day long, right? So as we said, Chafetz Chaim was very strict not to do these type of things, because one time a guy Israeli wrote a letter to his hosts, and he said, with all due respect, it's nice for you to host me, but if you know how I spit blood while I smell this food, and until you start the meal, I was like almost dead with hunger, and I was embarrassed to tell you how hungry I am. So people should be careful. When you have guests, you start the kiddush, you feed them, and then you can talk. You know, I know some rabbonim, we're now talking in the Pesach time. So some rabbonim rush to Shulchan Aruch, right, wrong, but they do that. And then during the meal, you can involve more with the Torah when you have especially guests that may be hungry. Avu abar hi, umanyamin bar hi, chad ksafi mikol mina umina. V'chad ksafi michad mina. So here is a different manner of rabbis, how they behave. One used to give the assistant all different food from all different time, right away at the beginning of the meal. One used to wait at the end of the meal, it's like almost left over, used to give him. So they said, ma'am mishtayel yao ba'deh, ma'am mishtayel yao ba'deh. So here is the concept, it's again, it's a little higher, but there's the idea that very few people are merited to see Elijah the prophet, which means this is a high spiritual gift from Hashem to see this level of Eliyahu HaNavi, and only those people who reach a level of piety that take care of people in need in such a level, they deserve to reach that level to see Elijah. Hanum Trei Chasidei, here is a given example. They said that it was the two righteous, pious people. Ve'amrela, Rav Nari v'Rav Pinchas b'nei d'Rav Chisda. This is the two names of pious people. Mar Kadim Safi, Mar Me'achar Safi. One used to feed the assistant before the served the meal, and one did it after. The Kadim Safi Eliyahu Mishtai Ba'adei. The one who bring the food before that, Eliyahu Navi used to talk to him. The Me'achir Safi Lo Mishtai Eliyahu Ba'adei. The one who gave the food later, Elijah did not speak to him. Again, it's the idea that in our understanding, Eliyahu HaNavi will come and talk to those who really feel for people in need. A story about the Rabbi Yitzchak of the Skver. This story goes that it was a shochet, it was a butcher, that he asked to fire him, and they did it because he didn't fulfill properly the mitzvah of Achnasat Ochim for hospitality to the guests. So he came and he asked him why you do it. So he explained, he said there's a verse in the Torah that said, Vayimaen Edom Natonit Israel Avo B'Givulo Vayet Israel Me'alav, that the Edom, the nation of Esau, the Edomite, refused to let Israel come and have the hospitality in their domain. So he said, you are a butcher, you are a shochet, you are born in Mazal Ma'adim in such a manner of dealing with blood. And you do not let Israel, you do not let a fellow Jew to come in your domain, but yet Israel may love, therefore you do not deserve to be a shochet. They sit in the entrance of Izgur, the king, which is the king of Persia. So they said that was the time of the Ravashi, he honored the sage of Israel, the same as the Gemara said in Zvachim, page 19. So they said, Khalif Azila Turgina de Malka. So he passed by the one who's taking care of the household and carry the food for the king. Chazir Rav Asher Marzutra, Rav Asher saw Marzutra. 1b, the Chavar HaPei, Shakal Be'etzba'atei, Anachli Befumin. So he had the face reached a point that he was like blanched because he was so deeply careful for food. So he took some of the food with his finger and put it in Marzutra's mouth. So this Dechemer explained that you have to differentiate between Isur Achilah, between the prohibition of fully eating a prohibited food versus some type of Te'ima. Te'ima meaning in some cases for saving life or the either total life-threatening situation or maybe Safek Pikuach Nefesh, maybe. So there are some notion of rabbis that you can have some type of taste just to make it and not to be in a dangerous situation. Amar Lei, so that person in charge said to Rav Ashi, Afsad Tzu Lisudata de Malka, guess what, you spoil the king's meal so because you touch it, so now the king will not eat it. Amar Lei, Amayte Aved Achi, so the policemen, the people around the king said, why did it? Amarlu, Ma David Achi Pasi Lemachal de Malka. You know that if someone does it, no longer the king can eat it. So the Shita Mekubetz explained that because I took a chance in order to save that person's life, but he said, "Amru le amai, amarlu davar acher chazai bei." The truth is, I saw some type of disease with this food. Some call it like a leprosy or some type of bacon or pork relate to food. This based on Gemara in Kiddush in 49b that said that there are certain food involved with oil or direct connection to a pork that create diseases. So they checked the meat and they couldn't find anything related to tzaraat or leprosy. Shakal etzba'atei anachalei. So Rav Ashi, he used his own finger and he put it on one of those pieces of meat. Amrulei hacha mi baddiktu. So he said, did you check this location? So I explained my book on Rashi. Rashi said here, כלומר, בדקתם את החתיכה הזאת. So based on the book of Nishaish, I explained here that he wanted to show them that their checking of this meat was not thoroughly, was just in one location. He showed them, but kuashkehu, that's almost like a miracle. They check this spot of the meat, and it turned to be something that carries illness. Remember, that was before the era of medical researchers or lab research. So it's in a way, you can say that it's a divine providence, or you say that he has the knowledge. אמרו לרבנן, the sages said to Rav Ashi, מה היית מה שמחת הניסה? Why you depend upon miracles? So again, there is a two different explanation. You go by the Shita Mekubetzet, he goes in two different directions, if it was real miracle or it's some related to knowledge. But the idea is that you endanger yourself more than you endanger the king if he will not eat it. So they said, the answer of Ashi Rispan, אמר לו, חזאי רוח צרה דקפרחה ילווה. Again, that's a little above the scope of this discussion, but it means that I saw the spirit of that disease hovering over that. So it's again, the big question is how far you go with that. The Ritvaz explained that when it's come to a safek pikuach nefesh, when it's not total saving life situation, it's maybe it's a question. It's if you remember when we study about metzia, you see it in the other places too, that if someone was not totally a swimmer, for example, and you see someone who's in danger, he's sinking, you go on a bay with your boat, right, and you see someone who's in danger situation, you're allowed to jump to the water. Remember that discussion between Rabbi Akiva and the Putra, the whole idea of your life take precedent before someone else's life, and if you're not totally familiar with the level of saving someone else's life, you should not take the chance. That's the famous Ritvaz response. It was a story of Romans. Some said, Ben Yehuda said, it's not necessarily Roman, it can be just a fellow idolater. He said to a woman, Minasvakli, are you willing to marry me? So, Amra lelo, she said, no, I'm not interested in marrying you. Azil aiteri mani, pali ve'achal kama, he was such a wicked person, he took a pomegranate and he ate at the front of her. So, in a way, he tried to seduce her to marry him. Kol maya de tzarali, she had like a secretion in her mouth, so because she wanted so badly to eat it, so it's carrying such a sorrow for her. Blaatei v'lo ava leha de zagla, so he created such a situation for her that she was almost dead. She was just puff up her body, and she was in danger. Lesof amar la, at the end, the Roman said to her, Im asina lach minasvatli, if I will heal you, I will give you a guidance how to be healed, are you going to marry me? So she reached a point of desperation. Amra le ein, she said, fine. Azil aiteri mani, so he went and he took that pomegranate, pali ve'achal kama, so he took pieces and he ate it. Amar la kol mai de'tzare lach, tuf shdai, tuf shdai. So every time that you have this sorrow, you just spit out those secretions in your mouth, and nafkele kihutza yiruka, until that she spit out such a green or some type of a palm green in atasai. So she was healed. So the big discussion among the poskim, among our rabbis. This is very applicable to you, my friend Steve, which is, if someone needs to make a living, he's desperate for fun. Is he allowed to go and serve in a place that is a non-kosher kitchen? Especially the poskim in Israel struggle with that greatly. If someone is desperate for fun and he in the culinary business or some type of food business, and they want to hire him for a place for people who are not observing the life of Torah and Mitzvot, if he allowed to go ahead and serve there for those people. Let's just finish. V'osa batzemer. So the Gemara said, batzemer in bepishtim lo. So again, here the question is, how far you go with that? A wife make a thread for the wool. So they said she must make thread from wool, but she's not obligated to do it from flax. So Gemara said, Rabbi Yudai. Mani matin Rabbi Yudai. Who is the Tana of the Mishnah? Is Rabbi Yuda. The Tanya, eno kofe lo la'amol lifnei aviv, ve lo la'amol lifnei bno, ve lo liten tevel lifnei bemto. So again, the big question is, the Rashba explained, you have to differentiate between alche parche, between people who just come around, and people who are really friends of a husband, and part of a husband's life. So again, permanent guest, not permanent guest, it's a big discussion about among the Ritva and Rashba. Anyway, אבל כופה ליתן לתבל לפני בקרוב. מי אומר, אף אינו כופה לעשות בפשטן, לפני שפשטן מסריח את הפה ומשרבה את השפתיים. So again, it's all depend upon, this is it's kind of create a bad order. והנמילה בחיתן הרומה. So again, here we talk about a special Roman flex, which causes the most damage. So there is a, that's the Tosfot said, but there is a halachic discussion, it's a big response, if you have a person with the elderly father, and the elderly father wants to live with him. So the wife doesn't need to serve the father-in-law. She doesn't have the obligation. And if she said, I don't want him in our house, so it's in the Nitzirat Chacham, but it's in general that it's a big hitting discussion among the rabbis, how far you go with the honoring father or honoring parents when it's conflicted with Shalom Bayit. In general matter, Shalom Bayit supersede, but again, each question is different. Rabbi Eliezer, Omer afilu ichnisa lo mea shfachot. So, because the idea is that if she's not at work, it can create a zima, a vanity, can create idleness. So, Amar Rav Melkiu, Amar Rav Ada Barava, halacha ki Rabbi Eliezer. So, meaning, he in a way, enforce or ask the Bedin to enforce her to do some work or to work because it's not healthy for a person to stay home and do nothing. Amar Rabbi Chanina Bered Rav Ika Shapud Shfachot Shapud is the Gemara Beitzah 28 said that it's Kalachar Yad he moved it, that basically if he roasted on Yom Tov so he cannot carry it on Yom Tov. So it's a mukzeh, he cannot move it. L'achar yad is a different story of the gumot. Rav Malkiyo said blorit. Again, that's the idlers, they used to have a large hair at the front of her face. They said exceeded more than the three fingers. Efer makle, it looks like a tattoo, heavy tattoo. Ugvina, Rav Malkiyo, so that's basically they eat it with the pork oil. So Rav Papa אמר, מדית ומדית הרב מלכי, השמעתת הרב מלכי, וסימנך מדית המלכתה. מי בנאי וכמנאי ושפחות. So who is the one who said that? I see we're running out of time, רב אנשים ומגליל אומר. So they said, even someone who מדיר את אשתו, he said to his wife not to do the סירת מלאכה. So they said that that's create שיעמום, that's create a idleness. היינו תנא קמא, that one said זימה, one said שיגעון. So ika benad, mitalta benuraita kitniyata venad reshid. So there is a one that she either taking care of the small dogs or they have this game like chess. So there is something occupying her. She's not in danger of doing all kind of stupid things, but occupying herself with the diversions of this type may still lead to licentiousness. So again, this is something that the rabbis are concerned. So in the previous Mishnah, page 59b, we dealt with the situation that the husband took a vow and prohibited himself to derive any benefit or any type of joy from her work of his wife. Here we're dealing with personal intimate relationship between husband and wife. המדיר את אשתו מתשמיש המיטה. If someone take a vow that he's doesn't derive benefit, doesn't have the relation with his wife, so it means that he prohibit upon himself the deriving joy. It's not on her because on her it's an issue, but on himself. Bet Shomai Amrim, it's shtei shabbatot. He can do it only for 2 weeks, not until it's completed. and she cannot require him to divorce her and to give her the ketubah. But they don't say Shabbat achat, only 1 week. Otherwise, she has the right to request a divorce immediately and pay off the amount of ketubah. So now the Mishnah add some type of limitation. Hatalmidim yotzin letalmud Torah shelo berushut 30 yom. So in general, the proper manner, the students can go and study, but they not allowed to leave the wife without their consent. So if that happened, it's up to the period of 30 days. So 30 days period, that's the manner of that time that the Gemara said in 62, that in those cities they used to do it once a week. So if he is living to a different location, he allowed to leave his wife without her consent, according to Tosfot, for 30 days period. Usually a person should not avoid relation more than the allow without her consent, but here it's in order to study Torah and etc. So you go in a period of 30 days. That's the way that Yeshua explained to us. But I said at tayalim, apoalim Shabbat echad, those who go to regular laborers 1 week. Haonam uaba Torah, the manner of relation that the Torah requires, there is a certain time involved with it, meaning the restriction of time, such as a person is obligated to have relation with his wife by the Torah. The Torah said in Book of Shmot, Exodus 21, verse 10, She'erak suta ve'onata lo igra. So one of the three items the husband is obligated toward his wife is the marital relation. The Rambam said in Hilchot Ishut, chapter 14, that that's an absolute biblical requirement. So therefore, it's depend upon the itim, meaning zman. The Ibn Ezra over there in the Torah explained that it's from the et, meaning a certain period of time, depend upon the profession and occupation the husband involved. So here they're giving several examples of what involved here. So Auna Mura Batura Hatayalim, those who are like a travelers. The Gemara explained later in 62 that there are those who travel for fun, or tour guide, or people who are at their home. It's a different interpretation. But anyway, those people, according to Rabbeinu Yohanan bar Tanua, it's basically people who have more the pleasure of being together at home. So, bekol yom, so it's every day. Apoalim shtayim b'shabbat, those labor people twice a week. Hachamarim, those in those days they used to ride donkeys. So those people who carry not they ride the donkey, but they carry materials, merchandise on their donkeys in order to sell it in the market in those different villages, achad b'shabbat, once a week, because they usually leave their home for 6 days period. Agamalim, those who carry merchandise on the top of their camel. So they go to long distance, achad b'shloshim, 1 in 30 days. Hasapanim, a sellier that go overseas, etc., etc. Achad b'shisha chodashim, because they travel. So they are once in a 6 month, that's the way the Meir in Shita Mekubetzet explained that that's sometimes the distance it takes them to come home. Maita Alma de Beit Shammai, what's the reason that Beit Shammai say that husband may force abstinence on his wife by a vow for a period of up to 2 weeks without being compelled to divorce her? So the Gamre Miyoledet Nekeiva. So the Torah said that it's avoid relation for 2 weeks when someone have a baby girl. The Torah used in Leviticus chapter 12, verse 5, ve'im nekeiva teled, if she bear him a female daughter, ve'tam'a shvu'ayim kenidata. So she is impure for 2 weeks for her period of time. U'betilel gamre miyoledet zachar. The Torah said, "V'yalda zachar v'tamash shivat yamim." It's 1 week, so that they, in a way, juxtapose the two. Beit Hillel namini gemarum yoledet nekeiva. So maybe Beit Hillel should go the same, and therefore that if it's 2 weeks, he doesn't need to divorce. If yoledet gamrelach namme, so it means that they shouldn't dispute Beit Shammai. Ela Beit Hillel minida gamrelach. You have to say that Beit Hillel derived from the halacha which regard to a woman that have a period, so she is prohibited from a marital relation for 7 days following the Torah law, במייקה מפלגי, what's the real disputation? מה הסבר? מי דד שכיח ומי דד שכיח? You have to go for something that is more common, like the relation by vow, that it's in a way common, that the husband can be angry, and therefore he does that. The same compared to some of his comment, like the isu nida, the prohibition of nida, but meniat hashmi, that's something that the avoiding relation, that's less common. ומר סבר, בית שמי הול, בידי דה הוא גרים לה. The husband caused it, because he avoided the relation by making this vow, ממידי דה הוא גרים לה. So now we will bring a views in regard to this disputation between בית שמי ובית שמי. מחלוקת במפרש. For example, if the husband said clearly that the cohabitation is prohibited to me for 1 week, so... אבל בסתם, if he doesn't give a period of time, so that can be for everlasting. דברי הכל לאלתר ויתן כתובה, so that's forever, and then he needs to give her the כתובה immediately. שמול אמר אפילו בסתם, בסתם נעמי ימתין, at least 2 weeks to, by the בית שמאי and 1 week by בית הלל, שמא ימצא פתח לנדרו, because maybe he find a way to be out of that vow, and that's by appearing before a sage or three uneducated people, but they come and find a way, that's the Gemara in the Darim, page 21, they let him out of his vow. So they find like a mistake that he made, or if you thought about this, you will not make this vow. So that's the way to let him out of that situation. Ha! So the Gemara says, Ha plige b'achad hazimna. So already disputation between Rav and Shmuel in regards to this disputation in different location, which is that something we're going to study in Mishna on page 78, Itnan. This is the Mishnah. Hamadir et ishto. If someone make a decision that vow that his wife prohibited from what? Milehanot lo. So from benefiting from him or his property. So therefore, עד 30 יום, if his vow remain in effect up to 30 days, יעמיד פרנס, he must appoint a trustee to support her. ליותר מכאן יוציא ויתן הכתובה, if he's exceeded more than 30 days, he should divorce her and give her the amount of כתובה. הרב לא שמור לה במפרש, that someone who spelled it out clearly, אבל בסתם, he didn't put the period of time, he didn't say it clearly, so that's for everlasting, יוציא לאלתר ויתן כתובה, he had to be immediately he needs to give a ketubah and divorce her right away and give her the payment for the marriage contract. ושמול אמר אפילו בסתם נמי ימתין שמה ימצא פתח לנדור. The same notion, excuse me, the regular case, he needs to wait. Maybe they find a way to be out of that vow, צריכה. So why you need the two? So why we have the disputation between the two Mishnah Yodit, Marbea, Iru, if we mention the disputation between Rav and Shmuel, in regard to a husband that prohibits his wife from relation behakam arav mishum delo efshar beparnas, because he cannot have someone that fulfill that obligation of cohabitation. Aval be'ayi, but in regards to prohibit her deriving benefit from his property, the efshar beparnas, you can have appointee trustee to take care of that. Ema modi le Shmuel, so that he needs to wait 30 days period before he divorced, because maybe he find a way to be out of that vow. Vit marbayi, if you talk about disputation between Rav and Shmuel in regards to a husband who prohibits his wife from his property, you say that behach kamar Shmuel, that he need to wait 30 days and he find a way to be out of that vow, because he can find some trustee to take care of her in that period of time. Aval beha, in a husband that prohibits his wife from relation, that you cannot find a substitute, ema modele lerav tzricha, so therefore, you need to have this disputation between Rav and Shmuel, it's necessary to cite the dispute in both cases, in both Mishnayot.
Malachai, Yeshuloim, Malachai.